No, the microphone is on. Thank you. Good afternoon for everyone. I'm really happy to talk in front of you today, especially in this wonderful museum. And I'm going to try to talk about a book which is not published yet, actually, which is going to be published next spring. So, as it might be a bit abstract, I don't want to read, you know, anything from the book itself. You know, I will try to contextualize the book, and starting with and connecting it to two very important concepts I've been working about for many years now. One being globalization and its effect, and the second one, which is more recent, the Anthropocene. Anthropocene, which is the subject of the Taipei Biennial 2014, that, you know, as you know, I'm the curator of, which started a few weeks ago. And Anthropocene is a scientific name given by scientists in the 1980s to this period, this geological period, which sees the impact of human activities on the planet. And from globalization to Anthropocene, I will try to introduce the idea of the X-form and its effects, I would say, on contemporary art. But the best way to start a lecture, you know, I think, is to define the subject we're talking about. What are we talking about? The first thing would be to define what, to do a very stupid thing, which is, you know, define what art is. You know, because it's, after all, there's nothing normal in this. You know, we have to redefine every time what we're talking about. And art is an activity which is first a tool to understand the world we're living in. I talked about globalization, about Anthropocene. Those topics are actually highly visible in today's art. Art is a specific level of understanding of the world we live in. It's a way to apprehend the world through sensitive cognition, through what we call a form. And there are four types of forms. It's been very interestingly defined by the French philosopher Roger Caillois. The four possible types of forms that surround us, and there's not a fifth one, there are only four, are first forms who are born out of growth, like plants, for example. Then you have the forms which are produced by accidents. Then you have forms created by moldings, by molds. And the fourth type of form is the form created through a project. That's what we're talking about. Art is a form which is born out of a project. It's a projection of an individual or a collective which produces a very specific type of form, which is not growth, which is not accident, which is not molding, but project. But in a way, contemporary art does include these four types of forms. Into, you can see in many exhibitions, you know, vegetal elements, or minerals, or molds, or also forms born out of accidents. But mainly, art, and I kind of like, you know, to start a lecture with very, you know, plain and simple definitions. Art is an activity which consists in materializing relations to the world. You know, it's like wearing somebody else's glasses. It and this materialization of a specific relationship to the world can be made with any type of element. It can be a gesture, it can be an object, it can be whatever is possible to materialize a specific relation to the world. Art is also different from many other activities by the fact that it intervenes within reality by producing effects in itself, actually. It intervenes in the real world through the result it does produce in its own domain. Because one of the common points between all artworks, from the prehistoric caves to now, is the fact that they are reduced models. It's a different scale. Even if the scale is 1-1, it still is a different scale. An artist can today, obviously, directly intervene into reality, directly work with reality in itself. It doesn't have to be a representation. But still, you know, art is this domain where things can be seen as if it was a reduced model, a different scale, I would say. And another specificity of this activity called art is the fact that it's also a way to bring back elements that we don't want to see as a collective, as a collectivity, for example. The British artist Liam Gillick, who actually did the intervention in the cafe here, was talking about actually comparing the activity of the artist as a dog who actually brings all the things that its master, you know, throws away, actually. And the artist is bringing it back on the carpet in the middle of the room, but, you know, it's a kind of centrifugal, centripete, you know, movement all the time. And this movement, centrifugal, throwing away things, centripete, bringing it back on the carpet, is approximately what I call the X form. It's the form as taken into a process of exclusion and inclusion. It's all the elements, all the signs, all the forms that are actually controversial, I would say. Controversial in the way that society doesn't want to see it, and artists are bringing it back, you know, into the scene. But as I was saying, after this introduction, which actually is a very large introduction, you know, which starts with something, the simplest thing possible, which is, what is art? What do we talk about when you talk about it? I would like to go back to globalization, which is actually certainly the main process we're all involved in at the moment. Movement which has actually started, let's say, a long time ago, but that we see the effects in the art world, I would date it from certainly 89. 89 as being the year where this big exhibition called Les Magiciens de la Terre, Magicians of the Earth, happened in 89. It was the first exhibition to include artists from all over the world. Because before that, in the 80s, if you look at the list of artists in any important biennial or any important exhibition, it was more or less always the same countries represented. 89 is also, obviously, the year of the fall of the Berlin Wall, and it's the year when started this movement of spreading out, you know, horizontalization of the world, which initiated what we call globalization in art. Globalization has a first effect, which is a very important, maybe even if it's not maybe the most spectacular or visible one, it questions the idea of origins. And in a way, I would say that this concept of origins, the idea of origins, is a common point between all the books, all the texts I've been writing since now. Revolutionary aesthetics, that has been mentioned, was an examination of the process of constitution of meaning in an artwork. Is it coming really only from the artist, or is it a collective process, a dialogical process, a kind of sharing between people? It's not in itself something which is new, but it's something which came to the fore at the beginning of the 90s, I would say. Even Delacroix was writing in his diary that for him, any artwork was like a cloud, actually. There was the artist condensating energy, condensating meaning that constituted the painting, and the beholder was the one who was getting the rain out of it, which is the meaning. It's always a triangle. And the relationship we have with art is always a triangular one. You have the author, the artist, the object, let's say to go fast, and the beholder. What's the origin then of an artwork? There's a very simple image which will make myself being understood. It's an image used by the French philosopher Louis Althusser, who was defining the materialist philosopher as opposed to the idealist philosopher, using a very banal image, the one of a train. For him, the materialist philosopher, let's start with the idealist one. The idealist philosopher, the idealist thinker, is a person who waits for a train in a station and knows where the train comes from and when the train goes. And then the materialist philosopher is the one who takes a train, but he or she doesn't know where the train comes from and when the train goes. Those are two very opposed ways of seeing the world. And I think I'm part of the second type. I don't know where the train goes. I don't know where the train comes from. And the best we can do is going into the train and try to discuss with our neighbors and do things within the train. In another book, Post-Production, I tried to, again, ask this question of the origins in a different way, because the main statement of this book is that the borders between the producers and consumers are more and more blurred, actually. What is a producer of culture? What is a consumer of culture? Today, you know, it's more and more challenged by many, many different phenomena. I would say that the symbolic character illustrating this blurring between production and consumption would be in music, for example, the DJ. He or she is playing already existing music, but he or she is doing something which is new at the same time. It's the chaining of the elements which is more important than the source of the sound. And if you take this metaphor again and use it for contemporary art, it describes also in many ways what's going on into the exhibitions today. For example, artists working with already existing structures. I would quote two, you know, which are very close to us today. Let's take Rikvid Travanija, for example. He's always using already existing structures. And that's an element, an aspect of his work, which is less seen by the beholders, but it's really as important as the conviviality it does produce. Recreate is always working out of pre-existing forms, is inhabiting them, is producing a way to inhabit forms from the past. And origins, again, and the last, you know, reflection I had about it is this book called The Radicant, which is a word which is actually existing in the dictionary. It comes immediately after radical in general in many Western dictionaries. As you may know, radical means belonging to the root, and radicant means it describes a plant or living organism which grows its roots while advancing, while progressing, like ivy, for example, or strawberries, for example. 20th century modernism was radical. And we're talking about radicality, radicalism, which is synonymous of getting back to ground zero, getting back to one root, one single root. And I think 21st century modernism will be about multiplying roots, multiplying our possible origins, because what we call origins is constitutive of what we call identity. But what is an identity? What do you have to be identical to? And that's a major question, actually. And I think that question is answered in many ways by today's artists. In a globalized world, I think we have to rethink the question of our so-called roots, our so-called origins, and privilege, certainly, the idea of multiple identities, the idea of changing, evolving identity, a moving identity. If you think about what a radicant is, it's this organism which grows and expands its roots, you know, while progressing. It's a new type of relationship between the individual, the subject, and his or her environment. We can actually produce new identities every time we move. And that's, I think, another element which is very much present in today's art. I defined at the very beginning the X form as a form which is taken into a process also. So it's a form which is difficult to seize as a stable form. It's a form which is whose identity is given by different points of views all the time. It's, for example, if you go back to the original, to the origins of modernity, I use the term origins in a historical way then. It's the whole history of modernism, I would say. It's the form as taken into the world of the official, you know, politics on one side, and the excluded on the other side. What we call modernism could be narrated according to the long fights given by the artists in order to give a dignity to ideas, objects, or themes that were considered as filth or insanity, you know, by the gatekeepers of cultural morality and by the dominant ideology. At every moment in history, in every place, there's the ideology, the official ideology, does produce exclusions, things that cannot be considered in the public debate, things which are excluded, expelled from the public sphere. And I think if you look at the history of modernism since for the last two centuries, you will see that, you know, those objects which are rejected are exactly the ones who are at stake in paintings or sculptures as rehabilitated by the artists. If we take a very academic, you know, example, let's say the Olympia by Manet in 1863, for example, what we could quote Courbet also. Olympia was a big scandal in France when it was actually exhibited for the first time. It was first rejected by the Salon, actually. And then it was shown 2 years later, in 65, because it was absolutely unbearable, you know, for the audience and for the official thought at the time. Because Olympia is actually, for everybody, every contemporary of this painting could recognize a prostitute and her servant bringing a flower. And this was absolutely unbearable. This is something that people didn't want to see at all. It was supposed to be unseen, invisible from the public sphere. It's first a prostitute, and two, and there's a very interesting text by Hans Belting explaining that it's clearly and visibly also a painting which brings about the idea of money and which presents itself in a way as a commodity. Two things which were absolutely unbearable for the audience at this time. So you have the bourgeoisie, the establishment on one side, and you have its contesters or outsiders on the other side. And in between, a large array of signs and images which are actually the kind of object of negotiation between the two. And we could talk about modernism in painting as the rehabilitation of subjects or themes in painting that were not supposed to be, you know, presented. The hierarchies of the subjects in 19th century painting was really clear and very, very codified at the time. History painting was a noble subject, but the asparagus of Manet was absolutely insignificant. And one could sum up the whole history of painting in 20th century and 19th and 20th century as the progression of those insignificant subjects as major themes for painting. Reality, as we know, is the product of a consensus. No, it's a discussion, it's a negotiation that we have together. If I tell you, for example, that I do have a pink rabbit on my shoulder, you know, you wouldn't believe me because you don't see it, but I might, if I'm really persuaded of it, I might, you know, tell you that this is the case. I might convince you, in a way. And we all have to make an effort to establish this consensus between us. Art is a kind of break or a fracture into this consensus. It does introduce into the sphere of the visible things which are not supposed to exist or not supposed to be seen at all. And that's, in a way, the movement of cultural life for the last two centuries. This kind of inclusion-exclusion process. And I think it's the key pattern for understanding the understanding of psychology, ideology, art, and history in the 20th century. It's the cornerstone of what we call modernism. I think also the modern artists has a lot to do with what Walter Benjamin called the materialist historian. And I'm going to quote, you know, the text that Walter Benjamin wrote about Baudelaire, a very interesting passage where he talks about the ragman as a kind of metaphor for the what he calls the materialist historian, which could be read today as a perfect definition of the artists. So Walter Benjamin writes, talking about the ragman, "There is a man responsible for picking up debris from a day in the capital. Everything that this big city rejected, everything that it has lost, everything it despised, everything it broke, he catalogues, he collects. He flips the archives of debauchery, the mess of garbage. He picks up, like a treasure, all the garbage shooed by the divinity of industry, which will become objects of utility or pleasure." In this little passage of Walter Benjamin, you have all the history of 20th century modernism in the way it's a process of rehabilitation of the despised, of the thrown away, the dog mentioned by Glenn Gillick, bringing back the bone into the carpet. And it's interesting to see how, in the last 20 years especially, but we could go back into the 1960s, of course, artists, many artists are becoming this type of collectors, collecting debris, collecting small elements that have been rejected by society. Many of them are doing excavations, trying to put into light things which are ignored or voluntarily ignored or rejected or buried in many ways. The artist can become a kind of archaeologist of the present, doing excavations. And it has a lot to do with our definition of history, actually. To quote Walter Benjamin again, it was actually one of the main elements of his political philosophy was the fact that history was always written by winners. Only the winners write history and impose their version of history. What's interesting is that there are counter versions of history, obviously. The ones, versions written by the losers, you know, between brackets. The ones who actually lost battles. And today, especially in the last 30 years, especially in the wave of the post-colonial studies, for example, one can see those versions of history which are not written by the winners, but coming from minorities, coming from micro communities or collectivities, which actually want to share their version of history, their version of reality. And to take an image, it's like exploring the battlefield to find what was buried, you know, into this battlefield, belonging to the losers. That's, in a way, the very theory of history by Walter Benjamin. This ambition in art has a name since 19th century. It's called realism. Realism, as Courbet was defining it, which is not trying to depict reality in a figurative way. It's much more complex than that. And Courbet's realism was more about bringing into the fore those elements which were rejected, painting workers representing all the minoritarian forces in a society. That's exactly the way Courbet was defining realism, not as optical realism, but as a political realism, which is an attempt to fight the idealization which is proposed by the power. Any power idealizes its prisons, idealizes its the forms it produces. And the role of the artist is to de-idealize those elements. Idealization is a process which consists in maintaining the world at its place, to justify, to give a legitimacy to the existing order. What art does is exactly the opposite. In a way, one could define art as a kind of editing table which does produce in a different way this movie that we call reality. Artists can re-edit the world all the time to show us new versions of the world, to show us how different things could be, to show us how fragile and precarious the power is, because any power is first of all a mise en scène, something which is set, a pile of scenarios that we actually go into every day. We are following scenarios. And art, the role of art, is to produce alternative scenarios. So realism, what Courbet calls realism, what I call realism today, and for me Liam Gillick is realist, for example, to give you an idea, and which shows that it's not about being optically realist. Realism is the critique of cultural hierarchies as they are. It puts into question the presupposé, the pre-thought elements that sustain the mechanisms of exclusion in any society. Realism is about looking for how we could unveil those mechanisms, how an artist can show the way we exclude, the way we expel, the way we reject things. That's realism. And it has, of course, a connection with not only art, but also politics, psychology. For example, if we take the subject of history, according to Karl Marx, for example, it's the proletarian. What is a proletarian? It's coming from the Latin proles, which means the person who has nothing else than his or her children as a wealth. That's the definition of proles, the one who has nothing than his biological, state to exist. That's the proletarian. What is the subject of psychology according to Sigmund Freud, still in the 19th century, as you see? The subject of psychology is the unconscious. Literally, what is expelled from consciousness to maintain our inner order. That's exactly the same, in a way. Different scale, but same process. The proletarian is expelled. The unconscious is what is expelled. And the subject of modern art in the history of modernism is the undervalued, the despised, the rejected, exactly the same. An artist, in this regard, is someone who thinks that the most insignificant sign, the most ridiculous or despised form or image, can have an aesthetic value. And this is the major pattern, you know, in the modernist history for me. The question we could ask to ourselves today is, what's the current form of this centrifugal movement? Because 19th century things were very much simple in a way. You got the power on one side and the artist on the other, no? Exclusion, inclusion. But today, things are much more complicated, much more horizontalized, I would say. And to understand the very specific nature of this movement today, of this inclusion, exclusion movement, we have to evoke two major characteristics of our times. The first one is, it's a very specific, you know, element of our culture, of the 21st century culture. For the first time ever, there is no terra incognita anymore. We absolutely have discovered every centimeter of the planet. And it's totally new. The last blank spots on the Earth were actually found, let's say, discovered and drawn at the very beginning of 20th century. It was in Borneo, the last blank spots. Now we know every inch, every centimeter of the planet we live in. It's a totally new phenomenon. No human beings have lived ever with this feeling of completion that we actually have today. There's no unknown place on Earth anymore. So I tend to connect it propose the following hypothesis that might be one reason why the artists today are so involved into the past, also into archives, into history, into discovering the past. Because it's the last continent to explore, in a way. It's not about space anymore. Discoveries and exploration are into time, both the future and the past. And if you look at the importance taken by history in the art of the last 20 years, I think that might be also an echo of this end of the terra incognita. It's a possibility, I would say. It's a hypothesis I'm producing. What's another byproduct or effect of this evolution is the fact that we are really living in a world which is presenting a kind of co-presence of time, actually. The past has never been so present than today in the history of mankind. And the main tool of knowledge used for it is internet, obviously. We have access to images of all times. You know, in a way, a painting by Vermeer or by Frank Stella or something which was produced last year, it's all at the same level today. There's a kind of, let's say what disappears under our eyes is the historical depth, this impression that we had in previous centuries that the past was very far away. Today for us, you know, Middle Ages or last century, it's exactly the same in a way. We have so many elements at our disposal. We can see so many different things, you know, from different periods, that if we look at the past, if we look at our vision of the time, of the history, it's like a constellation. It's like the sky at night. If you look at the sky at night, you will see what's called a constellation. And the characteristics of a constellation is the fact that the elements you see, the different stars you see, are coming from different times. Some stars that you can see have actually disappeared, and you can see only the ghostly presence besides a star which is much closer to us, and it's all at the same level, but it's coming from different periods of time. And that's, I think, the perfect metaphor for our vision of history today. This idea, this kind of pattern of the constellation is perfectly embodied by internet, actually. Everything's very flat, you know, in front of us. You can go from one side to another, and we have a kind of horizontality, you know. The idea of the constellation and its domination in our imaginary, and the way we proceed, the way we looking for knowledge today, it's exactly the same thing. You know, the constellation and the internet are really proceeded the same way. And the second element, which is characteristic of our 21st century, is what I would call hyper-production. Even when I started as a young curator, 25 years ago now, it was still possible, in a way, to have access to almost everything that was produced, you know, in the very specific domain which is contemporary art. It was still possible. In the 60s, it was really possible. Since, you know, the 90s, I think we're getting into a kind of world where it's impossible for any subject to know everything about his or her field, actually, in any domain, actually. The production, the general production of artworks, books, etc., is so high that it's impossible to know, to have a knowledge of any domain. So the idea of the cultivated person, as in the Renaissance was seeing it, is impossible anymore. We have to select, and the one who actually is today knowledge is not about accumulating information. It's about finding the right way to navigate, finding the right key to select, you know, different objects. And then again, you can see the echo of this hyper-production in contemporary art. For example, through the many works which are based on archives, for example. The idea of the collection I was mentioning before, but the idea of archive is even more specific. It's the idea of accumulating information, accumulating data, but most of it cannot be read or consulted. It's here as a kind of abstract knowledge. And the first work, I think, which corresponds to this idea is this piece by the Japanese-American artist On Kawara in 1971, which was called, whose title was 1 Million Years. Just the enumeration of 1 million years. Of course, nobody will read it, but it's conceptually very strong. It's the same year that than the invention of the, not the software, But there was this year in 71, the microprocessor was invented in 71, if I remember well. It's interesting to see it's very contemporary of this moment where the machine is becoming, is actually develops its possibilities of calculation much beyond the possibilities of the human being. And that's exactly the idea of archive. Nobody will see the totality of an archive, normally. It goes beyond our possibilities. And you see many artworks who actually exceed our possibility to see them, exactly like this piece by Onkawara. So we are living in a hyper-mnemonic world, a world of as the museum, for example, you know, which is a huge constitution of archives. It goes with the museum, and the museum exceeds our possibility to see it. It's a reservoir, it's a well where you can take things, but the archive exceeds our possibilities. The artist can be the gatekeeper of this memory and also can be the one who invents processes to navigate within history. I once defined the artist as a semionaut, from semios, the sign, and nautos, navigating. The artist as the one who navigates through signs, who invents ways of connecting them together. And in this world of hyper-production, this ability of navigation is becoming more and more important. That's our main tool of knowledge. What's our compass through these huge clouds of data that we're actually confronted to every day? And in a way, the artist gives us patterns or models to confront what's going on in our societies. Exclusion and the way things are expelled so goes hand in hand with this hyper-accumulation, this hyper-archive that we are actually living in. It's interesting to see that, you know, very different artists, and I would take three examples, Jeff Koons, Gabriel Orozco, and Pierre Huyghe, are actually mentioning or, you know, showing us different ways of treating, of mastering, you know, the different types of signs, actually. Jeff Koons, for example, is interesting in the way he applies the codes of luxury to insignificant signs, mostly childish or commercial, actually. It's really about the gap between garbage and pop culture. And this gap has a name in Jeff Koons' work. It's called capital gain, the added value, actually. It's not by random. If any sign or form used by Jeff Koons is coming from the world of the gift, the exchange, this kind of sleazy things you find in airports, you know, for example. It's really about it. Those signs he's using are coming, all of them almost, from this kind of sleazy, poor universe of the gift, you know, of the toy, of the gadget. And the work in general is about exchange, It's about showing the capital, I would say. And in this way, you know, it's the brutality of the capital which is shown in Jeff Koons' work. So it's not by random if it's considered by many as a kind of brutal work. At the exactly opposite is the work of Gabriel Orozco for me, who's actually using mainly construction materials, stones, tree leaves, animal fossil, etc., etc. Because the main tension that is given by his work is a tension between nature and culture in a world which is dominated by industry. So it's not nature and culture in an academic way. It's the way both of them, nature on one side, culture on the other side, are both dominated by industry, are both distorted by the industrial process. And what is the human being in Gabriel Orozco's work? It's a print, a mark, you know, a shadow, but nothing more. You know, there's no representation of human beings in his work, just the mark of it, just a fingerprint, some stains, but no more than that. The human being is actually fading away in his work. And that's interesting then also to envision in this regard the work of Pierre Wig, because he was one of the artists I've been mentioning a lot in the book Relational Aesthetics in the 90s. What's interesting in his work now is that he's going really from the human sphere into the biosphere, I would say. He's working in his last exhibition at the Pompidou Center. The new version of it will be at LACMA in Los Angeles. He's working with small animals like seashells. He even used bacteria, like the virus of the flu, for example, for an exhibition, or ants, micro forms of life. What's really interesting is to see that the shift from the human paradigm to a very much broader sphere, which is the sphere of the life form in general. And I think that's a very interesting evolution from the human sphere to the biosphere, which actually indicates also one of the most important stakes behind relational aesthetics. And this has evolved also, because when I wrote this book, there was no social networks. We didn't have any smartphones. Today we are talking, you know, to machines all the time, you know. I mean, it's absolutely natural for us, you know. It's something which is totally new. How many minutes do we spend every day talking to or through a machine? You know, now we have even objects speak to us. So it's possible that some people in the next years will talk to machines only, all the time. And we are more and more going into this direction. So this real stake behind relational aesthetics was the one, and I'm going to talk about it in a few minutes, what the one which was behind the Taipei Biennial this year. The idea of reintroducing the human within every possible sphere it deserted, actually. But I'm going to talk about it a bit later. To sum it up, you know, to sum up this new forms of rejection or the expelled today, I would say that the X form today is not what is rejected by one society and claimed by its dissidents. Because every sign has become an X form. I mean, a form taken into a double movement of inclusion and exclusion. The cultural hierarchies are not binary anymore. It's not a dialogue between the power and its dissidents anymore. It's much more complex, horizontalized. Because we're living in a world which is reticular, a world where networks, the fluxes of capitals, the fluxes of immigrants, etc., etc., are fluxes and networks are more important than places. It's interesting to see how, for example, to take another example, ethnology since the 19th century, for example, it was about sending people in Amazonias, for example, to take pictures or describe the life of the other. What has changed today, actually, is the whole definition of the other, which is not anymore taken into a binary system. If we take, for example, all the social networks, it shows that reality is now produced, the images of reality, the information, the documentation about one's life is not taken into account by almost everyone. You know, everyone has become a reporter. Everyone produces images. Everyone sends images or shares them. There's a collective elaboration, I would say, which was absolutely impossible only a few decades behind us. That's the difference between, for example, traveling and taking pictures, or, and that's an example that the film critic Serge Danet was using. He was saying he never took any picture, he was never photographing, because he thought photography was violent. If you take someone in a photography, it can be super violent. What he was doing was buying postcards, because it was the representation of the people by themselves, actually. Postcards have more or less disappeared, but stays, the metaphor is remaining. I was mentioning globalization. Now I want to get into another aspect of globalization, because it's a very parallel movement. It's what we call the Anthropocene, this geological era we entered, according to the scientists, since World War II, which is characterized by the impact of the human activities on the planet Earth. What is expelled, you know, today in the Anthropocene is, and that's a paradox, is the subject himself or herself, is the human being. And it's a paradox because the more our effects as a species is absolutely, you know, proven, the more we as individuals think that we don't have any effect on reality. That's what I call the Anthropocene paradox. As a technosphere, we actually have a huge, deep impact on the planet. As individuals, we less and less have an impact on societies. And we have the feeling, you know, that we cannot change things by ourselves. And I'm gonna get back on it, but I think that another characteristics of 21st century is the human being as the wreck of the system. And that's the way I would like to revisit relational aesthetics, and that's what I tried to do in the Taipei Biennial, and the exhibition called The Great Acceleration. It's interesting to see that in the recent developments of philosophy, first, the critique, the main critique, you know, that is produced by philosophy is a critique of everything that's centered. And obviously, it is important to criticize and deconstruct the so-called centers, you know, and try to horizontalize things more and more. But the critique today, the main critique is given, is actually against anthropocentrism. For example, relational aesthetics and the way, as a set of artistic practices that draws from the sphere of the human relationships as a point of departure, has been criticized as anthropocentric by many thinkers and philosophers. And I would quote this current trend in philosophy called speculative realism, which actually intend to talk about what they call the democracy of objects, putting at the same level objects, phenomena, human beings. There's a really interesting term, you know, pointed by the French philosopher Quentin Meillassoux. Our knowledge of the world is always the result of a correlation between a subject and an object. That's what he called correlationism, which is the typical perspective of Western philosophy. What's interesting, the question is, what would be an exhibition, what would be art without correlationism? Actually, it wouldn't exist, because the concept of art itself is based on correlationism, the co-presence of a human consciousness and a situation. As Marcel Duchamp was saying, the beholder makes the picture. And the picture, or any artwork, is transformed into a pure object, a pure commodity, if it's not seen and animated by a human consciousness. So that's the way I started to think, to revisit, in a way, the concept of relational aesthetics from the point of view of the, let's say, including the new landscape, our new relational landscape. I talked about the different types of machines we talk to all the time, but I could mention also our relationship, which is really evolving with nature, with the animal. And it's impossible anymore to ignore them, actually, if we talk about our relational sphere. So the Taipei Biennial was an exhibition trying to take into account the new developments of our relational world, in a way. But something has changed since the 90s. It's the collapse, I would say, of what could be called the human scale, very simply. For example, I would take an example. Our economy, actually, economy is normally something which is produced by the people themselves, you know. A society is organizing itself and does produces a very, let's say, I would start like this. No, let's say the word economy in itself, oikos nomos in Greek. It's the organization of the house. So it's something which is very domestic, which is very at human scale based. Today, 75% of the American economy only is based on machines, on robots. It's what's called high frequency trading. And human beings have become spectators and victims of their own infrastructure, of their own technosphere, actually, to the point that 75% of the financial mass in America is generated by machines, not by human beings anymore. So this exhibition started while I was reading an article saying that today on the internet there were more robots than human beings, you know, on the web, which is absolutely amazing if you think about it. It started in the 90s as a communication tool, as a tool for conviviality, for ameliorating our possibilities of exchange. And now the human being is a minority on this on internet, which is absolutely crazy if we think about it. What's the human being on the internet? Now it's personal data. Now it's a collection of informations made by robots, and we have inversed actually the system. So what's characteristics also of the new situation we're living in is the necessity of a kind of coalition between us as individuals, as citizens, and a new subordinate class, I would say, composed by animals, plants, natural elements, atmosphere, all attacked by a techno-industrial system which is now clearly detached from civil society. And here lays the possibility also of a new type of dialogue between the East and the West, between the Western and the Asian modes of thought, between being given that the presupposed idea of Western philosophy is this what Meyasu calls correlationism, the fact that it's impossible to see the world without thinking about the ego on one side and what this ego sees or perceives from the world on the other side. The world doesn't exist, according to Western philosophy, outside of the ego, outside of the human consciousness, which is the measure of all things. And here is the starting point of the exhibition. How is it possible to establish new types of connections between objects, natural elements, animals, life forms, and humans? And I will, let's say, briefly as much as possible, because there are 52 artists, but I couldn't select one image for all of them. But I wanted to show a few examples of this, let's say, new types of connections and dialogues between the different realms. It's not about diminishing under-evaluating the presence of the human. At the opposite, it's how is it possible today to show this huge coactivity sphere, which is the world. Coactivity meaning the fact that at the same time, human beings, life forms, natural phenomena, animals, all actually coexist in the same space and dialogue in many ways. Here is Harold Ankar, a Belgian artist, whose work is characterized by use of dust or fire, and the huge stack that you see on the left of the image here is actually the reprinting of the catalog of a zoo in Prague in the 1930s that he found actually casually. And we reprinted this really strange compilation of animals coming from a disappeared zoo as a kind of new Noah's Ark, in a way. Here is Alyssa Barenboim, who actually works on synthetic materials, new materials, polymers, here is Peter Buggenhout, also using dust as the main component of his cultures. Nathaniel Mellers, the two works that you see here are what he calls animatronics. Actually, they're talking and moving heads who are actually commentating the video that he did. Whose main character is the Neanderthal man that you see on the left. Shehzad Dawood, new type, and I'm talking about the sculpture, it's a 3D portrait. It's also interesting to see this kind of formal combination that is showing the way that the human representation today is always intertwined with natural or mechanical elements. As you can see with Egwe Young's work, which is it's a view of the installation, which is both a huge wallpaper and sculptures that are totemic, you know, forms in a way, which are involving both mechanical and natural elements. Camille Henrot's sculpture, it's a part of a series of sculpture where she actually asked different practitioners like a chiropractor or different healers to practice, you know, their activities on clay, and then she actually produced bronze sculptures out of this clay, showing just the back of a human being, but transformed into a sculpture. Roger Hirons' piece, which is a jet, a plane, reduced to dust. Neil Belufa, which is showing another aspect, which I didn't have time to talk about it, but which is very interesting, is the way that the internet and the screen itself has deeply transformed our relationship to the moving image. And for example, it's maybe not easy to see it on this slide, but it's like there was multiple layers of information involving videos and discussions with people, actually shown in the video, with a system of transparent screens, which makes the image cannot moves all the time, actually, and it's not never supported by any solid element. It's a close-up of the same work by Neil Belufa. Laure Prouveau actually presented a video, actually, that you can see in the black box inside, and all the objects, you know, on the left and the right are actually elements used to produce the video, which are actually belonging to the video itself. Mateus Rocha Pita, the Brazilian artist. Another aspect which is also quite contemporary, I would say, is this will to give a kind of density and a weight to casual images. It's cement, it's a series of works which are produced the same way that really cheap graves are made in Brazil. And Rocha Pita is actually selecting images of hands. You see the photograph that he uses, you know, on one and one part of the work, and he reproduces exactly the hands that are actually in the picture. Mika Rottenberg, a video also. She actually deals with production lines, I would say. And there are many different production lines in the exhibition, not only videos, but actually real ones, like Wang Po Chi, for example, that does work on a production line. Here, it's a totally irrational version of production, I would say. It's a very complex system and very absurd by the same way. Shimabuku, who actually discovered the similarities between one of the first and the most ancient tools, the prehistorical tools, and smartphones. Sterling Ruby, another very almost prehistoric, you know, rudimentary forms. And Surasi Kusalwong. The visitors of the exhibition were supposed to look, dig into this huge installation to find gold jewelry, which was actually hidden in the. So it was a kind of way to provoke kind of absurd activity, you know, within the space. Well, and I was talking about activity, passivity. Maybe that's the key word of what I tried to express today. What I called relational aesthetics was also a commentary on the way artists are actually generating activities among the beholder, among the visitors of the exhibition. Post-production was also about activity, about blurring the line between production and consumption of science. Coactivity, this co-presence of the animal, the machine, the human being, the natural elements, which was present in the exhibition that